Welcome everybody to the iBUG Buzz episode 660 for November 18th, 2024. I'm Greg, and I'll be facilitating the call tonight. If we have anybody that's new to the iBUG Buzz, whether you're joining us on this call or listening to a recording of the call, we are glad you're here and hope you'll join us each week for this call. The iBUG Buzz is an open forum where we encourage you to bring your questions, any issues you might be having with using VoiceOver on your iOS devices. And those devices would include the iPhone, iPad, Apple TV, Apple Watch. A few of you may have iPod Touches or HomePods. We also talk about apps that we use on those devices and accessories that we use with those devices, things like keyboards, braille input, speakers, AirPods. We've got a real busy schedule this week in the land of iBUG. Starting at all these times, I'm going to give you our central and all of the events you can get to through the iBUG Zoom link. Starting with tonight, we've got our iBUG Buzz. At the top of the hour, we'll go to some movie clues. We'll do an iBUG bite, just a short tip or trick, something you can do on your iPhone. At 9 o'clock, we'll stop the recording and switch over to the After Buzz, just a chance for you to informally chat and talk about everything other than religion, politics, and iOS technology. Tomorrow night, we've got the Mac Buzz from 5 to 6. Chance for you to ask questions and talk about everything Mac. Wednesday night, 7 to 8:30, we've got Android Insights. Thursday night, we've got Trekkie Talk from 8 to 9:30. And this week they're going to be talking about Deep Space Nine, Season 2, Episode 12 and 13. Friday night, we've got our virtual movie night, where we play the soundtrack and the audio description track for a movie. We open it up at 7:15 for just some fun and games. Start the movie at 8 o'clock, and then following the movie, we'll get some comments from you and have some trivia. And we still have something on Saturday. Saturday is the Apple Workshop, and this month the Apple Workshop is going to look at some of the new features on the AirPod Pro 2 and iOS 18. And I believe we're going to also have a presentation on the 11 Labs Generative Voice app. If you want to keep up with events that are coming up in for iBUG, you can go to our website, ibugtoday.org. You can sign up to be on the mailing list so that you'll get emails with events that are coming up. If you want to follow us on X or Instagram, you can do that at ibugtoday. We're on YouTube, ibugtoday. You can find our channel. And Facebook, we have a Facebook group, facebook.com/groups, that's plural, / iBUG Today. Any of these, the Mac Buzz, any iBUG Buzz, the cafe, and the workshop, you can listen to recordings of those through our iBUG Today website, on the YouTube channel, or on your whatever podcast app you may be using. We have a mentoring program, so if you're new to your using VoiceOver on your iPhone, we can get you working one-on-one with one of our mentors, and you'll find an application for that again on the iBUG Today website. I think that does it for all the introductory comments. Brad, if you can give everybody permission to unmute, let's go around the room and see who's here. And to do that, you're going to have to make sure you've tapped on the OK button on your screen, and then you'll need to unmute, state your name, and tell us where you're from. So I'll get things started. I'm Greg, and I am in Texas.
Raheel from Albany, New York.
Hi, Raheel.
Bridget in Atlanta.
Hey, Bridget. Welcome.
Vanessa in Atlanta.
Hi,
this is Herbie in Houston, Texas, and I'm hoping that we're going to beat Dallas, Texas. Oh, wrong thing.
Herbie, I know I'm missing that game tonight. Houston, Dallas. Somebody
in Reno.
Thanks, Mary.
It will actually be a game.
Pete, Florida.
Hey, Pete. Welcome.
Hey, Greg.
Joe from Ontario, Canada.
Hey, Joe. Welcome.
Gary in Austin.
From Ohio.
Hi, Pat. Hi, Gary.
This is Brad, and I'm in Dallas. And
hey, Brad.
I'm not optimistic.
I'm not either. They may both lose.
Yeah, well, yeah. I don't know what happened when they tried to open the roof today, you know.
No, what happened?
Okay.
All right. So, all right. Who else have we got?
This is Roy coming to you from the dining table.
Hey. All right.
Nice to be.
All right. Welcome.
Linda.
I got Elizabeth, and who else do we have?
Linda and Conroe.
Karen. Hey, Linda. Karen, welcome.
Hey, Karen from Philly.
This is Julie.
Okay, who was that?
Julie.
Hi, Julie. Hey,
hi.
Welcome.
And Dee down here in the bottom of Illinois.
Hi, Dee.
Hey.
Jake from Michigan.
Hey, Jake. Welcome.
Hello. Thank you.
Anybody else?
This is Ed from down there in Georgetown, Ontario.
You're in South Canada?
South Canada.
Yeah. Welcome. Welcome, Ed.
John in Austin.
Hey, John.
Hi.
Jody in New Hampshire.
Hey, Jody. Welcome.
Paul in Columbus.
Hi, Paul.
Deb in Kansas.
Hey, Deb.
Hi, Greg.
Welcome. Who else do we have?
Brian in Ontario.
Brian, welcome. All right, anybody else?
This is Innie from Iowa.
Hey, welcome. Glad you could join us.
Thank you. Yeah, that's my first time on Monday event.
Oh, is it? How did you hear about iBUG?
Well, I've been joining on movie night and the book club and Unplug and Cafe, but I've never done Monday night or Tuesdays on the technology one. So I'm excited to see. And I also got about the afterward event today also.
All right. Well, welcome. So, we're glad you're here.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
Liz Fort Worth.
Hey, Liz. Welcome. All right. Anybody else? Going once, twice. All right. So if you didn't get a chance to say hello, you'll have another chance at the top of the hour. So I think Jenny, is that right, Jenny? First time?
Innie.
Oh, it's Innie, I-N-N-Y. Yes.
Okay, Innie. Okay.
Yes.
I'm sorry. I've heard you on other calls. Okay. We'd like to give anybody that's new to iBUG a chance to ask a question. So if you'd like to ask something, fine. If not, we'll just open it up to everybody.
No, I don't have a question right away. I'll just see how this goes. Maybe I'll have. Thank you so much for this. Allow me this opportunity. I appreciate that.
Hey, we're glad you're here. We share. It's a good chance for us to share our knowledge and kind of learn from each other. So let's go ahead and open it up for questions. Who's got our first question?
This is John.
John, go.
I've been having trouble. I think since I installed 18, but I don't know, because I had it some before that, in getting Siri to answer. I try to invoke it and nothing happens. And I wonder if anyone else is having a problem. But then I have a number of other problems with dictation, and maybe they're related.
Okay. And tell me, John, are you holding the side button in, or do you have the HEY Siri enabled, or how are you activating Siri?
I have the HEY activated.
Okay.
And
good.
I have the home button.
Okay.
So I'm using my AirPods.
Okay. All right, good. Any thoughts on that? Help John out.
This is Pat.
Pat, go ahead.
there is a bug with voiceover and dictation, and I haven't noticed that it's been corrected, but it's been going on for a while where voiceover just kind of freezes up in the middle of something. And if you wait maybe 10, 15 seconds, it might clear up. If not, I usually hold the button and say, "Hey Siri, turn voiceover off." And then I say, "Hey Siri, turn voiceover back on." And it usually is okay.
All right, good. How about some other thoughts? Anybody else?
This is Liz.
Liz, go ahead.
As far as having problems with Siri itself, that's been going on for at least a year, and it's been getting steadily worse. I use VoiceOver. My husband does not, and both of us have equal amounts of trouble. And restarting your phone occasionally works, but Siri just doesn't seem to want to cooperate most days.
Okay. I think a lot of us have experienced that. Any other thoughts for John?
This is Ed.
Ed, go ahead.
Yeah, I use just the HEY Iris, Hey Iris, and I don't use my button. And I find that sometimes she comes back with a or hello or whatever. Sometimes I'll say goodbye and she'll say goodbye or good night. But sometimes she doesn't answer at all. Sometimes it's just the little sound that you get. And I find that sometimes if you change the pitch of your voice or say it a little bit differently, like just slower or separated more, just different things to your voice, sometimes changes it too. So you might want to try that.
All right.
This is Joe.
Joe, go ahead.
For those who are just waiting for Siri to answer, since I think 17 for sure, you don't, one thing about Siri is you can say, "Hey Siri, what's the weather?" You don't have to pause and wait for it to answer. That's why it's saying, it's just waiting for you to get on with it.
Okay. All right. So a few things for you to try there, John.
Thank you.
All right. You bet. All right, let's move on to another question.
This is Innie.
Innie, go ahead.
Yeah. I wanted to say, relating to the question from John, I'm having a similar problem, but only when, I tell Hey Siri to call this person or call, it always comes with somebody different. So now I only have, the only way I can do it, I can't just tell her to call this. I have to go to my contacts and find that person. But I also, what I ended up doing, I went to my contacts and I've been fixing them a little better. You know, like for the first name, I put just one thing and space it and put the second name just to see if he'll do better. Well, I have Siri. It's a guy voice. So, but it's still not working. So it seemed like, since I changed to the operating system, the 18.1, and so for texting is working fine, but only when I wanted to call this and that, just not working at all. So I'm just using my contact, going actually to the search. You guys offered a few things, so I will try.
Okay, one thought that I have on the on in your contacts, you can label each phone number mobile or work or home, and sometimes it helps if you say, if I say if I want to call my wife, if I say call Kathy mobile, then sometimes I get better results doing that.
Okay. Yeah, I do have a mobile, home, or work, but I don't usually mention it, but I'll do that. I'll try.
I think with one of the recent, maybe with 18, it seems to me like some of those labels got changed in my contact list, where it changed back to, I think it changed them back to home, or it seemed like there were several that were different, but you might take a look at that. Let's go ahead.
Thank you.
Pat, go ahead.
I just wanted to add something. Sometimes I've noticed going to a different app, you can't hear voiceover, and I'll do the volume up till I hear noise. And then sometimes that happens. It's crazy.
And that's when you're wearing AirPods or?
Yes.
Yeah. I've noticed that too. Okay, let's move on to a different topic.
This is Jerry from Vermont.
Jerry, go.
I just want to say hello to everybody, first of all. And I also want to say that I've been having, it's kind of a different topic. I don't know whether we can talk about them here, but the Meta glasses and Siri in combination, I'm having a lot of trouble. Even though my phone is connected to it, they're connected to Wi-Fi and everything. But I'll ask it to call somebody that I know is in my contacts, and it'll give me some crazy result. And it really is annoying, especially if I want to get in touch with that person. The other thing is the workaround for me. You know, that is true for new contacts, but if I go into recents or voicemail, I can sometimes get calls that I've gotten in the past week or two from somebody that I need to call back, and you can use the search feature to find them, just to let folks, that's what I do anyway. But it is right now 18.1 with all of the bad update thing is really annoying me. I got to tell you, it really okay. is. Thank you. All right.
Yeah, thank you, Jerry. Anybody want to comment real quick on their experience making calls using the Meta glasses? You don't want to spend a lot of time on this, but has anybody else had issues making calls from their Meta glasses? Okay. All right, well, let's move on. Another question.
Raheel?
Marie? Raheel and then Marie.
So I got my check-in history from my gym where I go to Planet Fitness via email. And when I open it up, it says image canvas. It doesn't give me a way to hit the share button to save to files, resulting me to do it on my Mac. Is there a way I can do it on my phone or iPad or anything?
So on the phone, it looks like in your email, you're getting an image.
Yeah, and it won't let me, there's no share button. All it does is puts me in the image area.
Okay, all right.
Go ahead, Herbie.
Yeah. Have you tried doing anything with the image, like double tapping, swiping, anything like that?
Yes, and it hasn't expanded my options of finding a share sheet.
Okay, Herbie?
I'm out of ideas.
Okay, Marie, did you have a thought?
No, I had a separate question.
Okay, all right, we'll come back to you. Brad?
He'll try turning on voiceover recognition and see if that'll do anything.
And voiceover recognition is in the road?
What is it, screen recognition?
Nobody can tell Raheel how to activate all that.
Yeah. Okay.
Sure. Things you have to do.
Joe.
Yeah. Joe, go ahead.
Okay, you got to go to your voiceover settings under accessibility, and then you can turn on your voice, your image recognition, and it'll have, I think that's also where screen recognition and all that stuff lives, and you can turn that stuff on, and then you can put it in the rotor so that you can turn it on or off as you need it.
Right.
Screen recognition or voiceover? I don't understand.
It's voiceover recognition is the category in settings.
Yeah.
And within that, you've got screen, text, and image recognition.
Turn all
so make sure screen recognition is turned on, and then you can access that.
Sorry if I screwed up.
This is Herbie.
Herbie, go ahead.
Two things. So, like, you know, the photo itself, like, are you showing it to somebody when you go inside the gym?
No, I need to, for my attendance history and invoice, I need to save it to my photos or wherever I need to save it to get, because I have to upload it to a special website for me to get reimbursed when I'm
okay. And then just real quick, on the Mac, it actually does show up as an attachment that you can save.
Yeah, so what I do on the Mac is I just open it and I hit Command S and I save it to my desktop, and then I'm able to upload it to the website that way.
Okay, so what you do there is you don't actually save an attachment, you save the email, and that I don't think...
No, not the email. I open the attachment and I save the attachment.
But you do, that's what I was asking, is you do see it as an attachment on the Mac side.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, that's what I was asking. The other thing I would have you... One thing with iPhone emails and attachments is sometimes the option for the attachment is below the email. So, like, you have to go all the way past all the email, and then you might see additional options there. So that's something else I would look at on the iPhone.
Mm-hmm. That's what I've been looking at, too.
Okay.
Could it show up as an image on the phone and an attachment on the Mac?
This is Herbie.
Herbie, go ahead.
I'm kind of wondering that, and I mean, it might be one of those things that's easier to do on the computer than on the phone, just with how they process things, but that's interesting, it's not being universally translated the same way.
Yeah, because some attachments, I could just open it and then hit the share button instantly to save it to my files or photos or wherever I need to save it to. But the picture like this, it only says image canvas, yeah, and it doesn't let me find the share button.
Yeah. Go ahead, right. Go ahead, Herbie, and then let's wrap it up.
So this is Herbie. So when it says Image Canvas, it's embedded in the email. It's not something you double tap, right?
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Because I wonder if it's something that... My only other thought is, would the Photos app somehow recognize it? Because that's the difference with the phone versus the computers. We have the Photos app and some... I wonder if there's some way to find it through the Photos app. That's an interesting problem we've got there, Raheel. All right, I'm done.
Thank you.
This is Jody.
Thanks, Raheel. Jody?
I just want to say you probably don't want to turn screen recognition on all the time because that can really mess up your voiceover. But you can add screen recognition to your rotor, yeah, and you can turn it on and off as you need it. So yeah, that, you know.
Yeah, just be careful that your rotor doesn't stay on screen recognition because it will cause you some problems. Okay, so let's move on. Marie, how about a new question?
Yeah, I think I know the answer to this question, and it's something totally different because we rarely talk about the Apple TV, but I have the first generation of the Apple TV 4, and I'm still using the original remote, and I'm wondering, and I believe that it is possible to use the new Siri remote with the older, as long as it's the version 4. It's the 4K model.
Who has the answer to that? Can she use a new remote with the
It's the newest. It's a third generation remote, the new Siri remote, and I believe I can use it. But my old Apple TV is working fantastic, so I don't need to buy a new one, which comes with remote, but you can buy the remote separately. And I just want to make sure it'll work with the one I have.
This is Paul.
Paul, go ahead.
Yeah, I checked that out myself, Marie, and you can use it on the
great
original.
Thank you.
All right.
All good. I needed to know.
Yeah, thanks, Marie. And thank you, Paul. How about another question?
This is Innie.
Innie, go ahead.
Okay. So, again, since I switched to 18.1, the you know, it came with they had in the rotor the voiceover, actually voice. I think it was Damasa, and they have Noel or whatever, like already two of them for one and two. And I did not I put it on Allison or Zoe, and it keep switching. It go back to the the one it came with, the Samantha, whatever, it just keeps switching. So I ended up going to the rotor and took it away, both. I took that voice thing from the rotor, went to the setting, and I removed it so I could solve that problem. I wonder if other people have the same issue.
Okay. All right, so your voices were switching, and you ended up just taking voices out of your rotor to...
Yeah, so I can go and switch it by do it myself. That's what I called accessibility care, and the person told me that's what to do.
Yeah, Herbie, go ahead.
I missed what they told you to do, but did they mention the quick settings?
Yeah.
Yeah, because what I've discovered is if I just put all the rotor items that can accidentally get triggered, just use the ones that I can in the quick settings.
So what you're saying, go to the quick setting?
Right.
So what I'm saying is take out everything that you find, like audio ducking, for instance. I find that I can, because I find that sometimes the rotor will like to nicely go to things that you don't necessarily want or need at the moment. So what I do is I'll take everything out of the rotor that I don't need immediate access to, and then you can get to the quick settings with the
two finger quadruple
tap. Yep. And just anything you need to change in the rotor, you can just change in there instead. And the advantage with that is the disadvantage is it's something you can't change on the fly, but the advantage is it's only going to be triggered when you want it to be changed.
So that would be a good option. There's a limited number of things that are in the quick settings, but you might check
the voices
that out.
Are definitely in there. So. Yeah.
So you could definitely have your voices in that quick setting, and that way you can get to it quickly with the two finger quadruple tap. And you declutter your rotor.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, thank you. And a quick question, another one. I've been seeing on Facebook people talking about the Life voiceover, how it can help them with finding things that I haven't turned it on, so I wanted to see what people think about that.
Okay, live?
Yeah, I think it's Life. It's in the accessibility, in the voice. You turn it on. I think it's
Life recognition.
Yes.
Sorry, Joe.
No, it's okay, Joe. Go ahead.
Yeah, that one. And it said how you turn it on if you're going to run into a chair or whatever.
This is Herbie.
Okay. Yeah.
Herbie, go ahead.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. It's not in voice, so it's a magnifier.
Okay.
That could be a very opinionated topic. So, like me personally, because I've been blind all my life, I honestly don't find such features useful because that's what I've got my cane for. But that's just me personally. So you're thinking of, like there's several different things like the door recognition, for instance, and the idea behind, like, for instance, the door recognition is to tell you when you're going past, where the door is at, but I'm as a Braille reader, I'm actually looking at the signs, Braille signs anyway, in most places that I'm at. So I personally don't find it helpful, but other people, might for different reasons. So I think that's an ability thing. That's my opinion anyway.
Yeah.
Joe,
go ahead.
I don't find it very useful right now, but I'm planning to get a Pro, and I'm wondering if it wouldn't be more useful with a Pro.
And I think with the Pro, was that automatically added to the rotor?
They were both. It was automatically added with non-Pro as well.
You have the all those magnification, the text and door and the scene recognition. Brad, go ahead.
I don't find them in the rotor at all.
I don't either.
No.
Several Pros. You have to activate, what is it?
LiDAR.
The magnifier.
Four-finger triple tap, correct?
Yeah.
Something like that,
yeah. And they're in there. But I heard you mention something about, door detection and getting it's a LiDAR feature, so it only works on the Pros, 12 Pro and newer Pros. Because that's when it was introduced.
Yeah. Right.
Well, they've introduced them with iOS.
But it doesn't work.
Various iOS versions, but LiDAR was introduced on the 12 Pro and Pro Max and been a Pro feature ever since. So unless you have a phone with LiDAR, you don't have door detection.
Right. Jerry, did you want to add something?
Yeah. I was going to make similar comments. I know it's with the Pros. I have a 15 Pro. I have not used it. However, I believe now if you go into your camera app, you can use it Well, I know you can use it as a scanner, and I suspect you can use it as checking out the environment. And for me, what I my go-to is the seeing AI or the AI that's available in what's the other one? Not seeing.
Be
AI.
My eyes. Pat, sorry.
You bail me out all the time, Pat. Yeah. So I mean, that I think is more reliable, and it's not just with the Pro phones, as far as I'm aware. So if you're I would concentrate on that and let LiDAR catch up with us here. There's so much to me anyway. My off the cuff comment here is there's so much for me that they really need to fix in this new update in December. It's supposed to come out, I guess. Thanks. Yeah.
Brad, go ahead.
Well, I can't address the Be My Eyes app, but the Seeing AI, the a world view is where you're probably using that feature, and that it requires LiDAR. So that would be a pro phone feature only. And as I'm aware of it, under Be My Eyes, the Be My AI requires you to take a picture, and then it analyzes the picture, whereas the door detection feature in the iPhone, one of the magnifier features that we talked about with the four finger triple tap, that's a live thing. It doesn't require you to take a static picture and have it analyzed. It's using LiDAR and it's live.
Okay, Liz, go ahead.
For those of us that feel handicapped on some of this lingo, I've got a 13 Pro Max, but I still don't really understand LiDAR. That could be explained a little bit.
Brad?
Yeah, Brad, go ahead.
LiDAR is similar to radar, which uses radio waves that it sends out and they bounce back, and it measures range detection, distance and all kinds of things like that. LiDAR is doing the same thing with light. It's like measuring the distance of something. I'm not sure. Obviously, it must be transmitting something and measuring how long it takes to come back. So, and it's similar to radar, but it's using light. And I believe, I'm not sure if it works out of both your front-facing and back-facing. I've only used it on when I hold up my phone and the back-facing camera is pointing, because I've used it and I've done demos on the worldview and seeing AI. And it'll scan a room and help you find things in a room and things like that. But it's the same concept as radar, only it's using light.
All right.
It's Joe.
Joe, go ahead.
Okay, I've got a 13 mini, and it has the live recognition, and it has text, point and speak, and scene. And those are the three it has. The others are, I imagine, are the pros. And I haven't really done much with the text. Scene, it's pretty useless, in my opinion, with this phone.
Okay.
But I haven't tried the others.
All right, good. Any other comments on
this? Is Brad, is she talking Brad about voiceover recognition?
No. Okay. The live recognition.
Live recognition.
It came with everything.
Yeah, I believe that probably is a LiDAR feature as well.
Yeah, that's what I figured.
Maybe that's what's in the rotor. Paul, go ahead.
Yes.
Yeah, I just wanted to note that the LiDAR emission is invisible, just like infrared is invisible. So even if you've got vision, you're not going to see any light.
All right, good. Thank you, Paul. All right, guys, let's move on to another topic.
This is Kenny.
Kenny, go.
Has anybody used the Apple Intelligence? And if y'all have y'all found any advantages?
Okay. Who has experience with Apple Intelligence? I know they're going to roll out a bunch more stuff with 18.2, I believe. Anybody using any features that would involve Apple Intelligence? But you have to have a 15 Pro for that? 15 Pro or 16?
15 Pro or the 16s, yes.
Yeah. Herbie, go ahead.
So
So shameless plug here, because the answer is yes, I have used the Apple Intelligence. However, I've only used it on the Mac. So if you come to the Mac Buzz tomorrow at 5 p.m. Central, I will gladly talk about my experiences with the Apple Intelligence. And I, from what I know, it's very similar to the phone. So it'll give you an idea of how it works. But I will just, in brief, I'll tell you that like the main feature I've used is the summary feature. And I think it makes a little bit of, I think it has like a learning module or something, because I think it's made a little bit of progress, but it's not necessarily the greatest. So, and I've seen articles, though, that, you know, regular iPhone users are not happy with Apple Intelligence on the phone. I will tell you that.
This is Brad.
Okay. Herb, are you through?
Yep, I'm through.
Yeah, Brad, go ahead.
I have it. I have a 16 Pro. So far, I'm not that impressed with it. When you turn it on, one of the things it does is it will summarize your iMessages, but the summary is often not all that useful. You may have had a couple of unread messages, and on your home screen where you might have a little alerts for the, you know, notifications of two or three messages, if it's in the same conversation, it gives you some summary, but when you open it up and read the individual messages, you're like scratching your head going, where in the world did it get that summary from? Yeah. So it certainly leaves a lot to be desired there. Now, on your email, you know how you can open email, and when you're looking at your inbox and you see an email message, or if it's a conversation that's collapsed, several email messages, and you get a 1, 2, 3, 4 line preview of the message with Apple Intelligence turned on, and there's a toggle in your mail preferences as to whether you want this enabled or not. Instead of a preview of the first few lines by showing you those first few, it gives you a summary of the email. And again, that's hit or miss. I don't use conversation view or mode or whatever it's called. I prefer just old school individual. I've played with it on the Mac more than on the phone, but it's the same. And again, the summaries are, they're okay. And since I'm dealing with individual messages, they're better than what individual mail messages, they're better than what I was seeing on the mail app, on the messages app on the phone with the summaries.
Right. Let me ask you a question. Will it give you a summary of an email thread?
Or that's what it's supposed to do.
The whole thread.
But
okay.
I said I don't use threading. I don't like it, so I don't use it.
Right.
But supposedly, that's what, when the thread is collapsed, it will summarize the unread ones. Now, if you swipe right or whatever you do and double tap on and expand the conversation, you are going to get what I'm getting now, a summary of each individual message if you have those previews turned on. When you open a mail message, up at the top, there's a little summary thing, and there's a button to enable it, but I have found it's weird with VoiceOver, and I have found that I just have to I could swipe up or down on it once I had to turn screen recognition on and then simply flick up and down, but without screen recognition turned on, it won't read it. So it's like not really VoiceOver accessible. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So it's weird. Siri, supposedly, this isn't enabled yet, that you can correct yourself while talking. However, I have found that sometimes I'll say something, pause, and correct myself. And when I read what I dictated, it sometimes seems corrected. Other times, it seems to repeat all or of what I dictated. But on further inspection, it's not really doubled. So why is it reading it twice? So, you know, hopefully this will get better. It's all a work in progress. I'm not sure what features they're going to bring out when 18.2, which I have read they believe is going to come out on December 9th, which is a Monday. But, you know, all these rumors, nobody really knows what Apple's going to do until Apple actually does it. But
yeah.
That's just what I've experienced with Apple Intelligence on my
All right. Pete, talk to us.
Yeah, the summaries that Brad was so aptly describing in both the
messages app and the mail app are essentially useless for me, Kenny. Regardless of what the summary says, if I get to an email and I flick to it in my inbox and it says unread, and then it'll say summary, I'm going to open the email or listen to my preview, you know, whatever I've set, like Brad said, up to, what, 4 or 5 lines. There's no summary that I've heard yet that has saved me the trouble of having to of wanting to open the email or flick to the text and tap on the text message. So essentially those summaries are pretty much useless so far to me.
Peter, are you using Apple Intelligence for other things on your phone?
No, those are the only, well, not that I've... Not that I recall, so no.
This is Brad. I'm not aware. Well, as far as summaries, you can use it, like Herbie was saying, you can highlight text, and I'm not sure how to do it on the phone. Probably it's in the rotor, I'm sure. You know, you can have it rewrite something, and I've had it rewrite things on the Mac, and, you know, there's friendly, and it sounds like some hip kid is talking, you know, something is really cool, and it's like, that's not what I wrote. Then there's very formal, there's concise, there's you can make it summarize the text you've highlighted. You can make it, I had to do a bullet list. Well, all it did was take every sentence and separate it out and put bullets in front of it. Yeah. And so, well, that's not very helpful,
right?
I don't know, it's weird. You play with it, see what you
think. All right, let's go ahead, let's move on beyond Apple Intelligence.
This is Helene.
Helene, go ahead.
Yeah, well, I was supposed to have a HOA meeting, and after 20 minutes realized that they changed it to Sunday, so I was happy to get back on the call because I've been trying to figure out how to get my Ray-Ban glasses, the smart glasses, to work with the new Be My Eyes. And I went into the MetaView app and, you know, and I tried to find a place. But what happens is I'm not getting a real person. I'm just having AI. And I called the accessibility number for Ray-Ban, and they were terrible. They were rude. First, it was Manila in the Philippines. Then they switched it to the States. And that guy said he wouldn't tell me where he's from. It's the States. And then didn't really know and couldn't help. And so I'm just interested, does anyone know how to make the Ray-Ban smart glasses work with Be My Eyes? I'm planning to use it in Arizona to say, take me from where I am, you know, like, what am I seeing? And then I can walk through the parking lots and get to the YMCA to work out. So does anyone know what to
this
do?
This is Innie.
Yeah. Innie, go ahead.
Yeah. I've been interested to get those smart glasses. And so I've been reading a lot on Facebook, and I belong to this group, and they were saying there's a lot of people having the same issue. It's being rolled out slowly to people. Not everybody have it yet, because they said when you do have it, if you go in Ray-Ban Metas, there is in the accessibility in the setting, you'll see it right there, Be My Eyes, and then you can click right on it. But some people saying, I don't see it. They said, yeah, it's not, just wait.
It's not
everybody.
This is Helene.
Helene, go ahead.
They do not have the word accessibility, but if you double tap on Meta AI, it in there, it says Be My Eyes. And when I tapped on that, it said what I had been saying to my glasses outside, that, you know, can you find my mailbox? And it said, your mailbox isn't over here. Perhaps it's further down the driveway. But this was still not a person looking through my glasses. So what I'm looking for is, I think I'm going to write to support@bemyeyes.com, because they don't take phone calls at Be My Eyes. So I'm going to write a support note, and then I can let you know. But I thought, if someone has done it and they're getting a person through their Ray-Ban glasses, I thought maybe someone on our call might help me.
Okay.
This is Thomas in Colorado.
Whoa, time out. Brad, let's let Jerry weigh in. Jerry, go ahead.
Just a quick thing. We had this discussion on one of my chats for Vermont folks and beyond on Thursday night. It's a tech chat, and what we determined is a lot of people are looking for it. Not a lot of people are finding it. It's just going to roll out slow.
Okay. So you may have to just be patient, Helene.
Okay.
Kenny is an actual user, yeah. Greg.
Okay. Kenny, are you there?
Yes.
Okay. Talk to us.
All right. On the 13th of this month, they slowly rolled out the Be My Eyes thing with the glasses. But however, they said, we're rolling it out, but it might not be available in your region. They did not define region. They said it could take up to a week or more. I'm adding the or more part because, you know, I think it's been a week. A lot of people, like Helene has noticed, and a lot of people, they've noticed they haven't got it yet. And they've updated to the latest app, and they've got the latest firmware to the glasses, and they have updated Be My Eyes, and they don't have it yet. And so the only thing people at this point can do is wait. And I know that's not what you want to hear, but there's lots of people waiting, and I've talked to people, and here's the interesting thing. One person did not have it. He closed his app, the MetaView app, opened it back up, went to settings. Right after communications under settings, it said accessibility, and then he tapped, double tap there, and then it said Be My Eyes, double tap there, then it has like connect, and he connected it. But that was just a fluke. You know, I'm not telling y'all to do that because it's probably not going to work. They are rolling it out, as far as I know. I don't know the rate or the pace, but whenever they did their talking about it on their Meta Connect 2024, they said it'll be out by the end of the year. And that's their, you know, that's, what's that company? It used to be Facebook. That's MetaView. MetaView. That's Meta. Excuse me. Meta said that. The CEO of Meta said we'll be out by the end of the year, coming soon. You know, it's coming soon. So they are trying to hold to that. And they know people want to use it. And it is just, you know, unfortunately, some people have it and some people don't. And there's no rhyme or reason for that. There could be a guy in Tennessee that just got it, a person in Texas, but the other person right next to the guy in Texas, he doesn't have it or she doesn't have it.
Yeah.
And and that's what it is.
Yeah. Okay. So a little patience. These are exciting times. I mean, feels like technology is just exploding as far as the new kind of things available to us. Mm. And I know with Apple Intelligence, I wonder about that because, boy, our experience with Siri has not been wonderful. And we'll see. It's just going to take time and we need to let things roll out. Jerry, go ahead.
I was wondering, new topic. Good. I'm looking at my Zoom app, both on my Sense player and my phone. And I see this thing called AI Companion. Has anyone used it? What do you use it for?
All right. Who can?
This is Brad.
Brad, go ahead.
Yeah, we use that in bits. If you enable it, it provides a summary of a Zoom meeting. And I receive these summaries. Bits does a Monday night MS Office class. So I've been getting these now every week for a couple of months since the class started back in September. They're hit or miss. It gives you a summary of what went on. And if you really read it and pay attention, you catch things in it, just like all this other AI stuff we've been talking about. It doesn't make any sense. Somebody will ask a question. And, you know, especially if you go back and listen to the recording of the class, I don't go to them live, obviously, because I'm in here. But, you know, it's what it is. It's a AI summary of a meeting. And you have to enable it, I believe, by going to the website of the Zoom account of whoever it is, the account that's hosting the meeting. You can't go to your account and host it, for example, and get an AI summary of this meeting. It would have to be enabled on, for this meeting, it'd have to be enabled on the iBUG account, and then it is emailed to the iBUG account email address. So, you know, it's an interesting thing, but again, like all this other AI stuff, I'm finding I take the usefulness of it with a questioning eye, I guess you'd question, you know. It's, these things are all getting better as they go along. So,
all right.
How useful is it? It's hard to say.
This is Jody.
Jody, go.
Yeah, I want to, Helene beat me to it because I was going to ask the question for her tonight. I think Helene wants to know, where do you, and I'd like to know too, where do you go in the MetaView app to find the connection to activate your Be My Eyes?
This is Kenny.
Is that under settings and then accessibility? Where do you find it?
This is Kenny
in Colorado. Yeah.
Kenny, go ahead, and then Thomas.
You double tap on settings, and there's a bunch of settings, and you go past your glasses, go past your privacy, go past communications. And right after that is where I found accessibility. And so I double tap there, and then Be My Eyes was there, and then connect Be My Eyes was there.
This is Joey. What happens if accessibility isn't there?
You have to wait for it. That's what Helene is running
into.
Oh,
that's what you have to wait for.
Yes,
okay.
You have to wait for it.
Yeah. Thomas, did you have something else?
Yeah, so I have used the Be My Eyes in my glasses. And when I first got the notice that I was able to use my glasses, I had to go into my settings, and accessibility was under general. So you go to general, then once you hit general, it'll go to accessibility. And the only thing in accessibility is the Be My Eyes. It does work very well, though.
All right, good. Thank you, Thomas.
This is Jody.
Jody, go.
So do you go to the MetaView app to turn it on, or do you go to general and accessibility to turn it on?
This is Thomas.
Thomas, go ahead.
It's in the MetaView app itself.
Oh, okay. Okay, thank you.
Okay, right. This is Kenny. So I have a question for Thomas.
Go ahead, Kenny.
So to get to this general, did you go to settings, your glasses, general, accessibility, Be My Eyes in the MetaView app?
That's Thomas? Exactly how I did it. Now, but I will say, when I first got it, I had to log out of both MetaView and Be My Eyes and log back in again. And once I did that, then the accessibility button showed up in the settings, and then I was able to complete the process. But I had to log out of both of them and log back in again to get it to work.
Yeah. Oh, that would be a nice...
So Helene, you might try that. Log out of Be My Eyes and the MetaView app, and then log back in and see if accessibility shows up. Thank you, Thomas.
This is Annie.
Annie and then Pat.
Okay, I only wanted to say that I thought Helene said that's not her problem, because she was able to get to Be My Eyes, but when it was turned on, it was not a live person. It was just a robot or whatever, and that's what the problem it was. Is that not what she was saying? Okay.
Helene, is that accurate? You wanted
yes.
Yeah, okay.
This is Thomas in Colorado.
Thomas, go.
So real quick. So when it is hooked up and it works correctly, you say, "Hey, Meta, Be My Eyes," and it'll make a sound in your ear, and then it makes the Be My Eyes sound in there right on your glasses. And it tells you that they can see out of your glasses.
Yes. This is Helene.
Helene, go ahead.
This sounds like a basic question, but how do you log out of Be My Eyes and MetaView? How does that mean? Do you mean I get rid of the app and then I have to put it back in? How do you log out of the app? Do you just push up the app, double tap on the home button, and then push it up to make it go away? How do you log out?
Okay, how do you log out of an app?
This is Thomas.
Thomas, go ahead.
So in Be My Eyes, if you go to settings, at the very end of settings, there's a logout button, and you can log back in through Google or Apple, so you don't have to do a password. And what was the other part of the question?
How do you log out of MetaView?
Oh, same thing. You go into settings, and at the very end, there's a logout button. When you do log out, though, you'll want to have your glasses nearby, because it goes through the whole process of having to reset up your glasses again when you log out.
Oh,
yeah.
No.
So just be aware of that. I had to go through all that.
Okay. Let's.
Thank you.
Yeah.
This is Roy.
Yeah. Roy, go ahead real quick. And then when you do.
Okay, I'll make it fast.
Yeah, go ahead.
I just wonder if they couldn't just update their apps by going to the App Store. Make sure the Today View is that tab is chosen, and go to your account and just make sure it's updated there.
Right. I think you have to. I think what they're saying, though, Roy, is that you've got to actually log out of Meta and Be My Eyes, and then log back into both of them to get this to work. Yeah. All right. Let's shut it down for the first hour and give. If we have anybody new that's joined us that didn't get a chance to say hello, this would be your chance. Who have we got that has not yet?
Virginia.
Three. Hey, welcome.
Kenny from Missouri.
Colorado.
Kenny, hey.
This is Desi in Franklin, Tennessee.
Elaine and Desi, welcome.
Deborah from Houston.
All right, welcome.
Jody, Canada.
Hey, Jody. Welcome. Anybody else? Okay. Going once, twice. All right. So now it would be time to see if the iBUG guy is out there and ready to do some movie clues. iBUG guy, are you there?
Yes, yes, yes. I'm back again. Good to hear all these wonderful people on the line tonight. Sounds like I got a good crowd going here. All right. So we are into our halftime show. And we are going to give out some clues to figure out what the movie is. But before I do that, last week we were starting to look at some uses of wax paper in the bathroom. And so we'll continue a couple more of those. Does anybody ever have soap scum on your tile in the bathroom or in the bathtub or shower or on the glass of the shower? Well, just take a little piece of wax paper, wet it, and gently scrub over those where that soap scum is, and it will magically go away, and your shower door and tile will be like brand new. How about that soap scum around your shower drain? That little metal drain somewhere in the center of your shower floor or the bathtub? You can again. This time, take that wax paper, crumple it up. Don't wet it, just crumple it up and start scrubbing around on that metal piece. And you will see the soap scum and any hair residue just melt right away. So there you go. Two more uses of wax paper. All right. Now it is time for All right. Yes, yes, yes. All right. Here we go. Clues for the movie. We got rules. You can stay unmuted. We want everybody to be unmuted, but you have to say your name, wait to be acknowledged before you can guess the movie title. All we want is the movie title. There are five clues. You get one guess per clue. And what else? Always forget the other one. Oh, if you were a winner in the last 3 weeks, you are ineligible. Chris, Pete, I know the two of you were winners in the last couple of weeks. So two of them cannot play tonight.
I've been found out.
All right, here we go with clue number one. All right, the setting of our film this week spans many miles and many years.
This is Jody.
Ooh, Jody.
It's a Wonderful Life.
It's a Wonderful Life. It certainly is, Jody. But it's not time for that yet. Come back in another okay. month. Come back in another month, Jody. So. Yes, we will be there ready to go with It's a Wonderful Life. Good try, Jody. Anybody else?
This is Jerry from Vermont.
Jerry from Vermont.
When Harry Met Sally.
When Harry Met Sally. Oh, that would be another great guess. And if we hadn't already seen it, it might have been the right answer, Jerry. Good try. All right, we're going to move right along here to clues.
Ed. Bird on a wire.
You cut me off.
Sorry.
All right, we'll go ahead and go back to Ed, who doesn't want to play this game correctly. Tell me that title one more time.
Bird on a Wire.
Bird on a Wire. That's a great movie, Ed. That's about, Ed. We may watch that sometime in the future.
Not charging.
All right, we're going to move on. Now, clue number, what are we on? At the film, at the film's premiere. Oh, no, I shouldn't be giving out this clue. This may detract from our audience this Friday. At the film's premiere. 240 people walked out on the movie, including actor Rock Hudson. Dun, dun, dun. I don't have my sound effects. I'm going to have to do them myself. At the film's premiere, 240 people, actually 241 to be more accurate, people walked out on the movie, including actor Rock Hudson.
This is Brooks.
Hey, Brooks.
Mommy Dearest.
Mommy Dearest. You're so close, and we have so seen that one already. Good try. We're going to have to post a list of all past movies so you guys look at that and not guess all those past movies. We only show movies once in the whole lifetime of iBUG, except for
Jody's guess.
Jody's earlier guess, yes.
Now there's one more.
Anybody else?
Ed?
Ed's back again. No, go ahead, Ed.
Rosemary's Baby.
Rosemary's Baby. Oh, baby. Ed, you are so...
Ed,
I have a good feeling. Wrong this time, Ed. Good try. All right. We are moving on to clue number three. We will be very dependent on the audio description since the first spoken words don't occur until 25 minutes into the film. Imagine that. Ooh, what are we going to do? No spoken words for the first 25 minutes.
It's Kathy.
Oh, Kathy, the famous person in our joke Friday night.
Yeah, you stop that. What about American in Paris?
American in Paris. Oh, my goodness. We have not seen that one. It spans many miles. I don't know.
And it goes into ballet at some point.
Does it span many years? I don't know if that works.
Nikki?
All right, we're going to go. Oh, Nikki, go ahead.
Whatever happened to Baby Jane?
Whatever happened to Baby Jane? Yes, yes, no. Good try.
This is Shree.
Shree.
How about Children of the Lesser God?
Children of the Lesser God. Is that where they are in the cornfield?
No, this is about some of his
Children of the Corn.
Yeah, this is about a lady who's deaf. Blind. She's actually deaf.
Oh, yeah.
It's got spoken words.
Guess what, Shree?
It's...
Wait, didn't you win in the last 3 weeks? What are you doing guessing?
Nah, I haven't won since probably a month and a half ago.
Oh, okay. Well, you still haven't won. Good try, Shree.
Yeah. I'm just keeping the streak going.
This is Jerry from Vermont.
All right, go ahead, Mr.
How about the Castaway?
The Castaway. Oh, that's a great one. I think we may have seen that. Maybe not, but we will not be watching it this Friday either. Good try, Jerry.
Kathy.
Kathy's back.
Oh, do I need to wait till the next turn?
You already guessed on this round, this clue. Sorry about that.
I'm sure I know what it is.
Thanks for your honesty. Just for that, I'm going to make an special exception and let you guess again.
What about Blue Lagoon?
Blue Lagoon. Yeah, I can see Brooke 240 Shields, people right? walking out on that.
Yeah.
Okay, but was that in the time of Rock Hudson? That's the big clue for you guys. But anyway.
He was old.
Yeah.
He was old, but he could still walk.
In the 80s, I think, didn't he?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, you know what?
Never mind.
Just like Rock Hudson died in the 80s, your guest died in the 80s also. Good try. All right, moving right along. Clue number four. The movie and novel by the same name were developed concurrently with the movie director and author of the book collaborating closely. Ooh.
Jody?
Jody, I've got a feeling.
No, because I don't think it has anything to do with Rock Hudson, but the only thing I can think of is 2001 A Space Odyssey.
Oh, Jody, I thought you might have come across something great.
Very few spoken words in that one, too.
Yeah.
Let's see, it may fit with the other clues.
Yeah.
Spans many years, many miles. I don't know about the people walking out on it. Maybe it wasn't that popular in the very beginning.
This is Shree.
And ding, 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 ding. Jody is correct.
Oh, my God.
We will be watching 2001 A Space Odyssey this Friday.
And I started out by saying I'm probably wrong. I should never say that.
Or always say it. Maybe it's your good luck.
All right. Way to go, Jody. I was counting on her to guess it if no one else could even figure out. And for sure, once we got to the bonus clue, it was going to give it away. I just didn't get the Rock Hudson walking out on it.
Yeah.
And why did all the people walk out?
Nut. He wasn't a Trekkie.
Yeah. In the beginning, the film was not widely accepted. Only in later years, it became a cult film. So.
Is that because it was silent?
It's just kind of slow going.
Futuristic and kind of political too. The monoliths and all that stuff.
So anyway, we're going to be watching.
What was your bonus clue, just out of curiosity?
Oh, the bonus clue is the famous match cut. Does everybody know what a match cut is?
No.
In the wrestling?
Match cut. That's when they cut from one scene to another, but in a match cut, is when they transition from one to the other one actually kind of match up. So that you go from like a certain color and the same color is in the next scene or a certain light.
Would have never guessed it.
Okay, anyway, that's the transition. So the match cut transitions from a bone tool to
the bone in the air.
To a spaceship orbiting Earth.
Was the bone flying in the air, right?
Yeah. Same shape. Yeah, it was a bone, kind of a bone-shaped looking saddle or spaceship. Yeah, all right, so we will be watching that. You better take a nap for this one. It is 2 hours and 28 minutes.
Do I win a trip to Mars? Oh.
We got to come back, yes, to winner's prize. All right, winner's prize. Oh, wow, look at this. iBUG was so fortunate. We got in on the bidding of some of the props. And so one of the cast members, or characters, astronaut Frank Poole, his spacesuit We got that one. That's the spacesuit in which he suffocated
right
to death whenever HAL 9000 turned off the oxygen to his
aircraft. It fogged over.
It has not been laundered.
Yes. But we have painted. We have painted stripes around the wrist and legs in true iBUG colors. So
all right.
We'll get that. Okay.
You need to model it for us, Jody.
We will now have to. Oh, what else? Am I supposed to say anything else? No. I think
I'm done. Did Deck Talk star in the movie?
Deck Talk, yeah.
So there's a lot of great trivia on this movie. So you would want to actually stick around even after a long, long movie.
Michael, yeah, quick announcement. Coffee. There will be a Facebook post up on the iBUG Today Facebook group asking for suggested songs for the pre-movie song games.
Oh, so take a look over there. Some.
Yeah. I'm going to limit it to no more than 2-3 suggestions per person, though.
Lots of good songs, yes, associated with that. 2001, A Space Odyssey. All right, folks, I am out of here.
In the jungle, the mighty jungle, the lion sleeps tonight. In the jungle, the quiet jungle.
Hey, Greg.
All right. All right. I think I'm unmuted. All right. So now would be the time in the call that we do an iBUG Bite. So, Brad, if you could go ahead and play that, and then we'll have some questions after the iBUG Bite.
All right. Here we go.
For tonight's iBUG Bite, let's take a look at the Spotlight Search feature on our phones. This is an incredibly powerful tool that you can use to search everything on your phone, access websites, schedule appointments. There's just an endless list of things you can do with this feature. There are two basic ways to access the Spotlight Search feature. The first is to go to any of your home screens and then do a 3-finger flick down from the center of one of your home screens. The second way would be to go down to your page selector at the bottom of any of your home screens, right above the dock, and it will say search and page 1 of 4. This was something that was added in, I believe, iOS 16, where they added that search to the page number. And that's another way that you can double tap on that page number and it will open up the Spotlight search. So let me do that by swiping down from the middle of one of my home screens. Again, 3-finger flick down.
Spotlight. Siri suggestions.
All right, and you hear Spotlight, Siri suggestions. Now, I'm just going to flick right.
Show more button.
So I can, this is a toggle, a show more or show less, which will just give me different options under this. Flicking right.
Mail.
Mail.
Messages.
Messages.
Settings.
Settings.
Safari.
Safari.
Text field is editing. Search.
And a text field.
Insertion point at start.
These are just some of the major categories that would be included when I do a Spotlight search. I'll talk you through one of the examples where Spotlight search is real handy, and then we'll actually walk through a couple other examples. Let's take a situation where I've sent out some emails about a recent DVD order, and I've also sent out some text messages related to the DVD order. And I want to find one of those messages that I sent out, but I'm not sure if it was an email or a text or what, you know, what the format was. So I can type DVD in that search field, and the results I'm going to get are going to have, they're going to be categorized by mail, and then I'll have recent emails that I sent out related to DVD order. The next category would be messages, and I'll have results that of messages that I've sent out related to the DB order. So it's real handy to find a thorough listing of everything that's gone out for that DVD order, and then I can tap on the one that I want to reference, double tap on it, and pull it up. A second example would be if I was looking for a setting, for example, if I wanted to go to the rotor settings on my phone, I've typed rotor in that search field, and let's see what kind of results I got.
Rotor, accessibility, right arrow, voiceover.
Okay, so it's told me the first thing I come to, it says rotor, voiceover, or I'm sorry, it says...
Rotor, accessibility, right arrow, voiceover.
Accessibility, voiceover. So it tells me the routing to get to the rotor settings. I can double tap on that.
Settings, voiceover, back voiceover, back button. Rotor items, button.
Okay, and it's put me right on rotor. So I flick right one time, it's got rotor items. And I could go in there and select which items I want included in my rotor. Really quick way to get to a specific setting. Plus it tells you the path to get there. Another example would be if I want to go to a website that I've asked previously. In this case, I've typed iBUG in the search field, and the results that I get on this.
iBUG, top hit.
Okay, top hit.
iBUG,
iBUG. Actions
available. Message, button. Actions available. Suggestions, iBUG. Websites. Show more, button. Zoom, iBUG today. Clock, ibugtoday.org.
Okay.
Actions available.
So I could double tap on that and go to the iBUG website. I'm not sure why it says clock. That sounds like a buggy thing.
Trainings and resources, iBUG today. Clock.
Training and resources. Okay, so I have, in the past, I have gone to the training tab in the iBUG website. So that is really cool that when I go to iBUG through the Spotlight search, I can pull up some of these tabs that I've been to and just go immediately to that training tab where I can find the past recordings of different iBUG podcasts. Just a real handy feature. And then if I keep flicking right.
iBUG today. Clock. iBUGtoday.org. Dropbox. iBUG Byte Dictionaries and Definition.
Okay, so this is pulling up some of the recordings that I've done for iBUG that I've stored in a Dropbox folder. And one final example I'm going to give is scheduling an appointment through the Spotlight search. So I'm in that I pulled up Spotlight search. I'm in the edit field. I'm going to dictate schedule iBUG meeting tomorrow at 3 p.m.
Insert a schedule iBUG meeting tomorrow at 3 p.m.
All right, now I'll do a four-finger tap at the top of the screen to get to the top.
Schedule iBUG meeting, circled, Saturday, November 16th, 3:04 p.m.
All right, flicking right again.
Add button.
Okay, add. So I'm going to double tap on that.
Cancel button.
Okay, now this is going to put me in an event screen. Similar to, it's the same screen that you'd do if you were scheduling the event in the calendars app. And flick right.
New event, heading, add, button, schedule iBUG meeting, text field, location or video call, all day, switch button, off, starts, 3 p.m., November 16th, 2000.
All right, so it's put that event in a calendar screen. All I have to do is hit the add button in the top right corner, and I've scheduled that event. So those are just a few examples of things you can do with Spotlight search. It's an incredibly powerful tool, that I have not used it that much in the past. But now that I understand some of the things that you can do with it, I certainly will be using it going forward. Hope this information has been helpful. All right. I'm curious to see if others have used that spotlight search. On the calendar event that I scheduled, the mistake I made on that is I shouldn't have said schedule. I should have just said iBUG meeting tomorrow at 3 p.m. and it would have titled that correctly. But it's just you can get to if I was to type in TikTok, for example, where I wanted to download the TikTok app, it would take me right into the App Store for the TikTok listing. So, Brad, if you can make sure everybody's unmuted, and let's see if others have used that Spotlight search.
Raheel?
Raheel, go ahead.
No, I have not used it, but besides using it for calendar and other things, is it possible to use it to check a battery status on an Apple Watch as well, like you could do with Today View? Because I know it pulls up the keyboard sometimes when you do like a three-finger right to go to Today's Today View.
Right. I don't think it would do that, Raheel. I don't think that would work. If anybody's had other experiences, please let us know. Other comments or questions on Spotlight Search?
Ms. Linda.
Go ahead.
I use Spotlight Search every day, but I haven't used it in the way you demonstrated tonight. So thank you very much. I learned a lot.
Yeah. There's just, it just amazed me when I started reading about that, the different things you can do with that. And it's just so quick to get to with that three-finger flick down. All right. Anybody else? Are people familiar with Spotlight Search and just have not used it?
This is Liz.
Liz, go ahead.
I discovered, I think it was yesterday, that instead of doing the three finger swipe left and right change to different home screens,
right,
if you are on the search, you can just flick up once or just use one finger to flick up or down and it'll change screens.
Right, that'll take you between home pages. Yeah, and if you double tap on that, it will bring up Spotlight Search.
Ah, okay. I'm gonna have to investigate more because I was surprised. I didn't know that's what it was. What my focus was on when it started going on to different screens. It's like, hey, that's faster.
Right. Yeah, and it now VoiceOver now says search. I think it says search and announces the page number.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
This is John.
John, go ahead.
Your presentation on Spotlight Search got me kind of curious. So I'm on my iPad and I did the keyboard command space and it brought up the Spotlight Search just like it does on the Mac. That's neat.
Okay. All right. John, have you used Spotlight Search for anything creative?
No, I have to say I'm impressed with your presentation because I never thought of like searching for links or apps or calendar, like doing calendar events. Those are some pretty creative uses for it. So thank you.
This is Helene.
Helene, go ahead.
I've never used it and I'm going to have to listen to your recording again because I don't really understand how to get to it. But I was curious when Linda said I use it for many things. Can she speak to what she uses it for?
Okay. Linda?
This is Linda.
Go ahead.
I just use it for a general search. Like if I want to search for something in Safari, I just, whatever I want to, if I'm looking for a recipe or a YouTube, I just put it in that search window in Spotlight.
Right.
I use it for everything.
Yeah, it will search everything on your phone. So you could put in any topic and it'll search in apps. It'll search in mail messages. If you've been to related internet links, internet sites, it'll pull those up. So you can just kind of go. And I believe you can navigate that by headings. I'm not sure on that. I'd have to check.
Would you mind very much just repeating very quickly how you get to the Spotlight? Because I didn't catch it.
Yeah, any of your home screens. Any of your home screens, you just do a three-finger flick down from the center of the screen. You know, if you're in the status bar and you do a three-finger flick down or three-finger flick up, that's going to take you to notifications. I think for the down. Yeah. But yeah, you want to go from the center of the screen, three finger flick down. Or if you flick right until you get to your page numbers where it says mm-hmm. one of however many home screens you have and just double tap, that does the same thing.
Thank you.
So this is three.
Three, go ahead.
Yeah, I use Spotlight to do calculations and conversions also.
Yeah, can do that.
This what, is what Terry.
Terry, go ahead.
Oh, if you were going to say something else, I'll wait for you.
No, go ahead.
So a comment, I know about it only because I have sometimes accessed it by accident, only I didn't know how to use it. So I just haven't worried too much about it. I've explored it a little bit. But my question is, you said that it will access anything on your phone. Does that mean that also include finding out things from the internet, or is it specifically delegated to things on your phone based upon whatever your phone remembers for things that you've done?
Now, you can do internet. You can go to internet sites. What I found real helpful, like on the iBUG, is instead of just taking me, you know, where I could go to the iBUG site and then I'd have to navigate to the training tab, training and resources. Mm-hmm. This it pulls that up as one of the options, so I can just double tap on that and it takes me right to the training and resources. I don't have to go find it on the iBUG site. It'll just take me right there.
Okay. But if I were to say, ask it, I don't know, who's the tall? What is the tallest building in the world?
I don't know. It's not going to tell you.
No,
it's not like a chat GPT.
It has to be stuff related to things that you've done or have happened on your phone.
Or things that are on your phone. Messages, mail, you know.
Yeah.
Sri, go ahead.
I was going to say, like, for example, if I searched on Spotlight AirTag, it's going to find all the documents that I've got associated with AirTags, but it'll also go to the internet and give me resources about other things about the AirTag.
Right. So, yeah, it gives you a variety of results. The example that I used, that first example, you know, I could go to mail and search in the mail app for a particular topic, but then I wouldn't know if that was in messages, if I had sent a text message about it. So in Spotlight search, I can do one search of the phone and it will give me results from mail, messages, and like Sri was saying, if they're related internet sites, it'll pull them up or give me a link to them.
This is Pete.
Pete, go ahead.
When you first accessed it, you flicked to a couple of things before you got to your search field. Were they apps? Were they messages and mail and things like that?
They were categories.
Okay, because I tried that and it gave me some different categories. Like it gave me a Siri suggestions was my first option, and then WhatsApp, because that's one of the apps at the top of my screen, followed by messages. Those are the first two apps on my screen, one of my home screen. So I don't know. I guess it varies depending on your content.
In the interest of time, I did not go into settings. It used in the settings app, it used to be called Siri and search, the category, and I think now it's just called search. But there aren't a lot of settings, but there are three or four things that you can toggle on or off.
Okay.
I think I have everything toggled off because I kind of wanted to not have a real cluttered
results.
That
determines what comes up in your Spotlight search. Okay.
Right.
Thank you.
Yeah, okay.
Pat,
go ahead.
I did start playing with it last week a little bit, and I was doing it to add a calendar event. It was helpful. And also, I have several pages of apps, and I was trying to remember what something was called, and I put in something similar, and it did come up with the app. So rather than S-I-R-I, I have put it in the search field and it'll pop up. But I haven't played with it that much, but it is very helpful. And I was looking for an email about something and I did put that in and it did come up. So I've used it similar things that you have used. But right. I have found it helpful, and I think it's a great addition to the phone.
Okay, great. Thank you, Pat.
Miss Linda.
Linda, go ahead.
Just one more thing. Mainly what I use it for is to search the internet.
Okay.
So that's what I use it for mainly, but now I'm going to use it to search things on my phone. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. All right, let's go ahead and move back into questions and issues. And we got about 25 minutes left. Let's see if we've got some more questions or issues.
Right.
Pat.
Whoop, I got Pat and John, and was there a third person?
Raheel.
Okay, Raheel, let's go ahead with we haven't heard much from John. Let's get John and then Pat and then Raheel.
Yeah, so I do apologize. This might be tied to the topic, but I was just wondering because when I'm on my home screen and I turn my rotor to handwriting mode, I can write a word, like let's say settings, and it would bring up the settings app. Like, is that part, that function tied into the Spotlight search, or am I just using a general search with the handwriting mode?
Let me throw that. I don't think it would be tied to Spotlight search, but any thoughts on that?
This is Sri.
Sri, go ahead.
I think it's not using Spotlight. It might be using like your settings, because I see where you're going with it, but I don't think Spotlight opens up when you do handwriting. I think it's just like when I search for settings, it's just when I type the letter S, it's just pulling out every letter S that's tied to that home screen.
Okay.
All right.
I think about not the home screen, because it does pull up, it pretty much pulls up all the apps. That's what I meant to say. It brings up all the apps. Because it'll tell me S has 30 apps or something.
All right, good. All right, let's go on to Pat and then Raheel.
Thank you. I noticed since 18.1, the way notifications comes up when you go to check notifications, it used to have calendar events at the very top. I'm not seeing that.
Okay, so when you pull up your notification center, it's looking different and you don't have calendar at the top?
No, it used to have calendar because that's tied up for a specific time. And if I was busy, I was on a phone call and I went to notifications and it wasn't there. I'm like, why isn't it there? So I had to open calendar to get to the event tonight. I'm like, why did they remove it from the top?
Okay. Any thoughts on that? I'm wondering if that's, is that dependent on whether you have something scheduled that is at hand? If you don't, then would it not show up?
This is Pat. I was on a phone call and I have an alert set for 15 minutes and then 5 minutes, and it wasn't at the top of my screen. Green on notifications. So okay. I'm like, why did it disappear? I'm like, I don't know.
Has anybody experienced that? Okay.
Yeah, I'm experiencing the same thing.
Okay. With 18, either 18 or 18.1, I'm having an issue where notifications are not coming through on my AirPods or they're not consistently coming through. If I have a message, instead of getting my alert, I don't hear anything. And the phone call, when phone calls come in, they sound very, on the AirPods, AirPod Pro 2, they sound very distant. I think there's some notification stuff going on with 18.1.
Me too. This is Pat.
Yeah. Go ahead, Pat.
I was going to say the same thing. Since 18.1, I'm getting weird things happening. And I also wanted to make a comment about AI. When I came into the Zoom meeting tonight, it did say something about AI, and it is an option, but you know, I have heard other people say it's useless, the summary, but they did add it on your iBUG Zoom.
All right. Yeah, we talked a little bit about that earlier. Okay, Raheel, did you have a question?
Yeah, so is there a shorter command to, instead of me swiping with three fingers to get to today view and check the battery in my Apple Watch, it keeps bringing me to the middle of the cursor, like search or calendar, instead of bringing me to the battery all the time where I have to like swipe down and explore until I get to battery. And I'm like, yes, I could finally check this. Or yes, I could finally check that, like AirPods Pro case. How much battery is in the Apple Watch battery? How much is in there? And also, I've been noticing that my Apple Watch Ultra has been charging to optimize limits. How do I wait until it goes up to 100? Because sometimes at 8 a.m. Eastern, I have somewhere to go when a car is waiting outside, and I don't want to keep my worker or my person waiting for me.
Okay, so you have two questions. One is there a short way to navigate the Today view to get down to your battery view? I think this, the answer to that is no, but Sri, go ahead.
Have you thought about putting just the battery widget on your phone?
I don't know how to do that.
This is Brad.
Okay, Sri, do you want to tell him how to do that?
Probably not today. But
okay, all right. Yeah,
it's going to take more than a 10-second.
Okay, Brad, go ahead.
Well, I was going to say the same thing as Sri. But the other thing he asked about battery optimization, go into settings on your watch, go to battery, and you can turn that off, and it won't stop at 80%. It'll always charge to 100%.
Right.
I'm not too worried about it. I've had my watch Ultra for a year and a half, and my battery shows still at 100% of original capacity.
I'm
not too concerned about it. I'd rather it charge to 100% every morning than worry about optimizing my battery.
Right.
If it charges to optimize limit, though, would it go up to 100% eventually? If charge it at 10 p.m. and get up at 6 in the morning?
I don't know. It should figure out when you take it off, just like it does on the phone. Like I said, I just turned it off. I don't find it necessary on my watch.
Okay.
This is Herbie.
Herbie.
Just real quick, we do have an iBUG Cafe on widgets, and I seem to recall, I know that Maria did a demo on that, so Raheel, you might want to go research to find that podcast. It is a couple years old, and I want to say it was like 2021. It was right after widgets were introduced. I do know that, so.
Okay.
This is Brad.
Yeah.
They're not Brad. Widgets. They're complications.
Complications on the
and
watch.
And it hasn't changed since the watch came out.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I was thinking about the one for the phone, but.
Yeah, yeah. No, you want a complication on your watch, not a widget.
Oh, that's totally different than what I was thinking about. Never mind
then. Open the watch app. You'll see the faces. Tap on whatever face you have active, and it will open up all the settings for that face, and you can see where you can add or change whatever complications you have for that face. And right. It's pretty easy to find better.
This is Sri.
Yeah, Sri, go ahead.
I was going to say, I could probably put a demo and post it on our Facebook page on the complication to put up a battery on watch.
Yeah. And different watch faces have allowed different numbers of complications.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the complications that I have on my watch face, where I can just flick left and right and hear the time and the battery. And then for your AirPod, Brad brought up a few weeks ago that if you put both AirPods in the case and open the case and put it close to your phone, that's going to give you, it'll give you the charge on each AirPod and the case. So that's a real quick way to do it. I do that all the time now.
This is Pete.
Pete, go.
Just a quick comment. I asked in the Spotlight search field, what is the tallest building in the world? And it gave me an answer.
Whoa. Right.
It did
Thanks
a Google search,
that.
And by the way, it's in Dubai.
And how tall is it?
It didn't say. At least I haven't flicked that far yet, so I don't know.
All right. Thank you.
This is John in Austin.
John, go.
I just wanted to go back to what Pat was saying about notifications. I've had that same identical problem. Notifications just seems to be really crazy. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. I just can't figure it out. I think it's a bug.
I spent about 3 hours on the phone with Apple accessibility, and the bottom line is they said you have two choices. You can wait for the next software update to come out and see if that just happens to do something behind the scenes that fixes it, the problem I was having. And the other thing is you could reset all your settings, which I'm not quite ready to do that.
Sounds a bit drastic for just that.
I'll wait.
This All right. Sri.
Sri, go ahead.
I have a new question, if I can ask.
Good.
Going back to the Ray-Ban, but it's one of the tabs. So I have a log of all the questions that I asked the frame. And when I'm in that tab, I can't seem to figure out how to get out of it. There's no close or back. So I was wondering how to go to a different tab. I've been just closing the whole thing out.
Okay.
Rahil,
go ahead.
Sri, couldn't you do the two fingers scrub, Z scrub, like back and forth?
It didn't work.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Gotcha. Other thoughts?
This is Deb.
Deb, go ahead.
I've had that same issue too. I've had exactly the same experience as Sri. I've had to close the app to get out of it.
Okay. All right. Anybody else? All right. So there you go, Sri. Maybe with the next update.
Mm-hmm. This is John. Thanks.
John, go.
I have a clarification question because I've never used the MetaView app. So I know with some apps, like you can kind of jump out of stuff by going from tab to tab. Like, so this, the MetaView app, you really have to close a menu before you can go to another tab.
So what I'm experiencing with VoiceOver is from the top to the bottom, all the way to the bottom, is just this call log of what I've asked the MetaFrame. There's no tabs in the bottom. There's nothing. It's just a bunch of just communications that I've asked request with the frame. So, I was looking for, all kind of four finger single tap, touch and explore, all the way down the bottom, trying to figure it out. But it just takes me to, just one of the questions that I asked the frame. So,
and you can't, if you do a three finger scroll, you can't get any lower.
You know what? I have not tried the three finger scroll.
Yeah.
Try that one.
Okay. Ooh. All right. How about another question?
This is John.
John, go ahead, John.
Hearing John from Canada reminds me about 2 to 3 weeks ago, he mentioned a podcast called Double Tap, which I was not familiar with. And since then, I've listened to it, and it's very helpful, clever, and charming, I'd call it. And I just wanted to put in a plug for it. It's pretty terrific. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yeah, Sean Priest also does some real good demos of features, tutorial kind of things. Yep. He's very entertaining. All right, thank you, John. Who else did we have? I heard somebody else speak up there. Another question or comment?
This is Innie.
Okay, Innie, go ahead.
Yeah. So that's probably a very stupid question. Somebody showed me how to do it before, but I don't remember again because I don't use it often. How do you close all the icons when you open them? Like, I know there's a tab. What do I do to close all the tabs?
How do you close apps?
The apps, yeah. You know how when you go places, you open things? How you can close them?
Okay. And you're speaking about an app like the Messages app or the Calendars app. Is that what you're asking?
No. The icons.
The icons.
The tabs. Well, when you have those the tabs, like I don't know. Wait, how do you close all your tabs? It's on the homepage. Yeah.
This is Joe.
Joe, go ahead.
Are you talking about tabs on Safari?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay,
yes.
Good. Thank you, Joe.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
Okay. I can tell you what to do then. you do a long press on, you go to the tabs on the bottom of the, you got the tab, you got the bar, the toolbar.
Yes.
And on the far right, you have tabs on the far right bottom. You do a long press on that or a triple tap if that's what you prefer. And then it'll bring you to a dialog box and then you can close your tabs from there.
Right. This is Pete.
Okay.
Yeah, Pete, go ahead.
Yeah, Annie, just to add to what Joe said, she's right, though. But at the bottom of your Safari app, there are five, I believe, tabs. The very bottom right is called tabs. Mm-hmm. And a long press, I think the easiest way to do it, just to simplify it for you, if you do a one-finger triple tap, if you go 1, 2, 3 with one finger, it will open a dialog. I think the very first item on that dialog screen, the new screen that comes up, says close all tabs. If you do a single finger double tap on that, it will close all of your open search tabs that you've used to search with.
Right here.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I had to call Accessibility Care before and they showed me, but I don't use it often now and I forget, but I'll try it. Thank you. Thank you for explaining.
Rahil?
Okay, Rahil, did you want to add something?
Yeah, so what the Apple Store creatives taught me was you go to the Tabs app. No, not app. What am I saying? The bottom, like where the tabs are. You double tap on tabs. And then at the bottom, very bottom on the right, there's a done button.
No, that's not the one.
It's a done button. You triple tap. No, not triple tap. You long press, like double tap and hold on the done button. And then it brings up the dialog box.
Right. This is Herbie.
Close it all out.
So I'm just an observation here. It seems like you save a step, but that's not a bad way to do it. But it seems like you would save a step if you do it the way that Joe described, excuse me, by triple tapping the tabs button at the bottom, you know, instead of going into the thing and then doing. So it just seems to me like you'd save a step. So.
Right.
So,
hold on.
Like
guys.
Pete
Be
mentioned.
Sure state, hang on. State your name before you start talking and let me recognize you.
This is Innie.
Innie, go ahead.
Yeah, I thought I was still. So that's what Pete mentioned when you do one finger, three taps. And that is what's called also the long press.
Yes.
Or that's okay. All right. I got it. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah, this is Herbie.
Herbie, go ahead.
So just real quick, you've got the long press, which is one short tap and then one long tap that you hold, or the equivalent, Tim, which is the three-finger single tap where you just do three fingers. And there's a number of apps that you can use that command
it's
in and
the
find.
One-finger triple tap.
Yeah, one finger. I thought that's what I said. Maybe I didn't. I don't know.
You stand it on your head. You set it backwards.
Okay. One-finger triple tap. There. But I find that easier to do than the long press myself, honestly. But you can find that very useful in a lot of applications, like in the music app especially, and others too. So just thought I'd mention that little tidbit.
This is Shrek.
Sorry, go ahead.
Oh, no, I was just going to say, Greg, you were correct. Three-finger swipe up did bring up those tabs in the radio manner. So thank you.
All right, good. Yeah, that long press, the one-finger triple tap is what I typically use. The long press is like a one-finger double tap and hold on that second tap. So tap, tap, and hold for your long tap. All right, we've got time for another, maybe one more quick question. And
this is Sri.
Sri, go.
You know, one thing I do want to clear from what Rahil said, sometimes on the bottom right corner, you will get a done button, which is typically when you're in a browser of some page. That's when you have the option to hit the done. Otherwise, you should see the tab button on the bottom right corner. And if you do see the done button, just do a double tap to accept the done button, and then you get the tab back up.
Okay, good. Thank you, Sri.
This is John.
Jody.
John and then Jody.
So I know we kind of exhausted the whole thing about tabs, but I also just wanted to let people know that I think within Safari settings, you can also automate it so that it will close your tabs after a certain period. I don't remember what the increments are, but if you don't like manually closing your tabs, I think there is a way to like automate it so it'll close them after a certain period of time.
Right. You can set the length of time. Jody?
Just the tallest building is 163 floors and it's 2,720 feet high.
Thank you for that, Jody. Okay. God, we live in a world of information, don't we? Lord. Okay. We're getting close to the top of the hour. Let's go ahead. Let me review real quickly the events that we have coming up. So tomorrow night, we've got the Mac Buzz from 5 to 6 p.m. On Wednesday, we've got Android Insights from 7 to 8:30. On Thursday, we've got Trekkie Talk from 8 to 9:30. On Friday, we've got our movie. You can get in as early as 7:15 and stay as long as you can stay awake. And on Saturday, we've got our Apple workshop, and I'm looking forward to that. The new features on the AirPod Pro 2 and iOS 18 and the 11 Labs generative voice app. I'm looking forward to that. We're going to turn the recording off. Brad, if you can do that, we'll Oh, and let me say thanks before we're done. We got Brad and Herbie and Julie all providing backup for tonight's Buzz call. So thank you guys. And we're going to have either Jody or Terry taking over for the after buzz. So stick around and share your thoughts on the after buzz.